Yeah, dear student, welcome back to the business study class. Our chapter going on is chapter 9, financial management. And today we are going to study the capital structure, concept and factors affecting. In the previous class, I gave you the introduction about financial planning. So financial planning is the, I'm giving a quick revision of that. Financial planning is a process of estimating the fund requirement of the company and to specify the sources from where you are going to draw that money. It is very necessary to recognize. We have to always follow the twin objectives of the financial planning. What are those objectives? First, to estimate the requirement of fund. To estimate the requirement of funds. You have to continuously assess the situation when you are supposed to bring the funds or you are in need of money. Right now, pandemic is going on, so everything is volatile, turbulent. You can't predict anything. So you have to estimate the requirement of the fund. And second objective is do not raise as unnecessarily. Do not raise the funds unnecessarily. You should always arrange the fund when it is required. So you have to always remember the sources who can immediately replenish your funds. Clear? Because in share capital, in accountancy, what we are studying is to call the share money in installment. Why we are calling? Even a rupees 10 per share is called in installment. 2, 3, 2, 3. Why? Why we are not in a position to call it immediately? Anybody can pay it. If anybody is applying for 1 lakh share or 10,000 share, he can pay 1 or 10 lakh easily at one time only. Why to call it in investment? But the problem here arises, you have to show the ROI. Return on investment. Clear? So that is the most important thing you have to see and recognize. Because for example, if you are constructing any highway, flyover or any building complex for a 100 crore, but you are not in need of 100 crore. So raise the money as and when required. Do not raise unnecessarily. This is the basic concept of financial planning. Clear? Now in financial planning, we have decided or estimated the funds requirement of the company. And we have also got the sources from where we are going to arrange the money. But how much money is to be arranged from the internal sources and from external, external sources, that we decide in capital structure. Clear? So we are going to study the capital structure. So first we see the concept. First, we see the concept of capital structure. Clear? So it refers to the mix of debt and equity. Clear? Capital structure means composition of your capital. How your capital has been constructed. So from where you have arranged the sources. So it refers to the mix of debt and equity. Clear? Now debt means, debt refers to the loans, borrowed fund. Clear? Borrowed from outsider, bank, financial institution, a specialized bank. Clear? And from equity. Equity means shareholders. Shareholder fund refer to the, in balance sheet I told you, it consists of shareholders, share capital and reserve and surplus. What reserve and surplus can be? Favorable balance of general balance, security premium or whatever types of reserve are you are containing. Reserves are created to strengthen the financial position of business. So how much loan you will take? So that equity is also known as, that equity is also known as external. And shareholder fund is known as internal. So how much externally you are going to arrange the capital and how much you are going to internally arrange the capital. So external is called debt, loan, borrowed fund and equity. So what will be the composition of debt and equity? In the previous class I told you about there shall be a judicious mix of debt and equity. But how you are going to decide that what percentage of the debt and equity is judicious? So again, that depends upon several factors. So that thing is called, that we calculate it by debt equity ratio. How we are going to decide that what is the judicious use of the debt and equity or judicious composition, that we are going to recognize by this ratio. Clear? Debt equity ratio. So formula is debt upon equity. Clear? Whatever debt you have taken and what is the composition of shareholder fund and reserve and surplus in your capital. Clear? Now according to the industry standard, the ratio decided is 2:1. Debt equity ratio decided is, standard is 2:1 or 2/1. You can also see this 2. Now what does it mean? That for every 2 rupees of a loan, you are having 1 rupees of capital. This means you are 50% secure. Okay? If it is 1:1, it's very good, fantastic. Your every money is secured. Composition of that means 1 lakh is your, or 1 rupee is your debt and 1 rupee is your equity. It's very good. But if it's 3:1, 4:1, then these are the situation of money. So according to industry standard, our ratio is 2:1. Means for every 2 rupees of debt, 1 rupee of loan is available. Clear? So according to this ratio, we have to construct our, or we have to design our capital structure. Clear? Now the proportion of debt in equity is called financial leverage. The proportion of debt in equity is called, the proportion of debt in equity is called financial leverage. How much debt is to be taken by you, that has to be decided. Okay? So that thing is called financial leverage. So the simple rule is that the moment the cost of the debt is lower than the profit, it is called the situation of favorable financial leverage. That means you keep on taking the debt. This simple means if your loan is available at the interest rate of 5-6%, okay? And your return on capital is 12%. It's very easy, clear? You can take the loan. So the proportion of the debt in equity is called financial leverage, and financial leverage is favorable and unfavorable. So when it is favorable, when the cost of the debt is cheaper than the return on profit or lower than the return, this is called the situation of favorable financial leverage. When it is unfavorable, when cost of debt is higher than profit, clear? Means reverse situation. When your ROI is 6% and cost of the debt is 9-10%. Clear? So this we are going to study. Clear? As the financial leverage increases, the cost of the fund declines because of the increase of cheaper debt, but the financial risk increases. So the moment if you keep on taking more and more debt, what will happen? Your financial burden of paying the interest plus principal increases. Clear? And that thing is called trading on equity. Clear? That is also called trading on equity. So as the financial leverage increases, the cost of funds decline because of increased use of cheaper debt, but the financial risk increases. The impact of financial leverage on the profitability of the business can be seen through EBIT EPS analysis. Clear? Now how much debt is to be used, cheaper debt is to be used in equity, that we can assess through a situation called EBIT EPS analysis. What is EBIT? That is earning before interest and tax and earning per share. Your profitability or return is assessed through earning per share. How much your one share has earned. If you are having good EPS, it is shows your financial strength. If you remember in dividend decedent, we studied the factors for dividend. So first point, one point was that stability of earning. If your earning are stable, definitely you will give a good amount of dividend. So earning of per share would be definitely very high. So we are considering one imaginary situation by taking some figure and to explain you that up to what extent the use of debt is good. So this thing will help you in designing your capital structure. When you will do your business, it will helpful for you to design your capital structure. Clear? Here is one imaginary situation in which we are dealing. Clear? See. Here three situations are given to us. Clear? So first we have taken EBIT, earning before interest and tax. Our EBIT is 4 lakh in all situation. Rupees 4 lakh. Rupees 4 lakh on all three situation. Clear? Now it is EBIT, earning before interest and tax. So first we are going to reduce interest, less interest. In case one, we have not taken any loan, so put a dash mark. Clear? In situation 2, there is an interest of rupees 1 lakh. And in situation 3, there is an interest of 2 lakh. Clear? Now we are going to subtract it, and what we will get in return is EBT. That is earning before tax. So in situation 1 it will remain 4 lakh only. In situation 3 it is 3 lakh. Situation 2 and situation 3 it is 2 lakh. Okay. Now we have got EBT, earning before tax. Now we will subtract the tax. Less tax at the rate 30%. So here it will come to, because tax is applicable in all situation, 1,20,000, 90,000, clear, and 60,000. Clear? This we will get PAT, profit after tax. It's 2,80,000. 2,10,000 and 1,40,000. This we have got profit after tax. Clear? Now we will see the number of shares. Rupees 10. Clear? Now how to find out EPS, that is profit after tax, to be divided by number of shares to be held by you. Clear? So here we are again 3 lakh shares in situation 1. In situation 2 we are having 2 lakh. And in situation 3 we are having 1 lakh. Clear? Now we will calculate EPS over here. So the formula is profit after tax to be divided by number of shares. Okay. So here it comes to 0.93, here it comes to 1.05, and here it comes to 1.4. Okay. See, now what is the difference and what this table is going to predict to you or tell to you. In case one, we have not taken any loan, this means we are in a very sound position, but still our EPS is very low, 0.93, even not a rupee. Clear? In situation 2, we have taken a loan, clear? And we have paid tax also, but our EPS is 1.05. And we are paying just 1 lakh as interest. In case 2, interest is double, clear? Interest is double by, now it is 2 lakh, clear? At the same time, our EPS is also rising. That comes to near about 1.4. So this means whenever cheaper debt is available, you can use more and more of debt. Because see, even if you have not taken the loan, your tax profit is high and you have to pay more tax. In situation 1, not taken any loan, you have paid 1,20,000 as tax. In situation 2, you have paid 90,000 as a tax. And in situation 3, you have paid 60,000 as a tax. So in case 1 and 2, the tax is doubled, and in so you can't say that not taking a loan is a good idea. Clear? This is called, so this thing is called trading on equity. What this thing is called? This thing is called trading on equity, because you are having a composition of share capital as well as debt in your company, but you are taking more use of the debt instead of equity. So you are doing trading on equity. So your EPS is rising, because what we studied in financial planning or management, that we have to increase the shareholder wealth. So here shareholder wealth has got getting increased. Thus the shareholder are like, so shareholder likely to get due to the debt loan computed in the total capital employed, and our EPS is rising. So this thing is concept is for trading and equity, which refer to the increase in the profit earned by the equity shareholder due to the presence of fixed capital charges like interest. See, tax you have to must pay in every situation, but with the advent of the loan you are getting plenty of the fund, as well as your interest burden is rising, but it is reducing your tax liability and EPS is increasing. The shareholder are likely to gain due to the debt loan component in the capital employed, and with higher debt EPS rises, because it is the cost of the debt is lower than company's return, which is calculated as follows. Clear? So here it is a situation of, this situation is called, this is a situation is of favorable financial leverage, where cost of debt is lower than the rate of return or return on investment. Clear? So how we are going to calculate ROI? Clear? How we are going to calculate ROI? So formula of ROI is the formula of ROI is equal to EBIT, earning before interest and tax, into 100 upon capital employed. Clear? Into 100 upon capital employed. Clear? This is the situation of ROI. Clear? Now see, in case 1, what is our ROI? In case 1, our ROI is EBIT, earning before interest and tax, is 4 lakh. So 4 lakh into 100 upon capital employed is 3 lakh shares of rupees 10 each, 30 lakh. So our ROI is 13.33%. Clear? While the loan taken at the rate 10% is 10 lakh only, and we are paying 1 lakh as interest. Clear? So this is higher than 10%. So our ROI is better. So this is a situation of favorable financial leverage, where cost of debt is lower than the ROI. This is higher than the 10% increase rate on debt. With higher use of debt, the difference between ROI and cost of the debt increases the EPS. This is a situation of favorable financial leverage. Clear? In such cases, companies often enjoy more of cheaper debt due to enhance the EPS. Clear? Now we are going to assess the second situation. Clear? I am erasing this data, and we are going to consider a situation of unfavorable financial leverage. How and when this thing will happen? Okay. Now see second situation of EBIT analysis. Company Y Limited has total capital employed of rupees 30 lakh. The rate, tax rate is 30%. ROI is 10%. And EBIT is 2 lakh. Three situations are considered. Situation 1, there is no debt, unlevered firm. Situation 2, there is a debt of 10 lakh. And situation 3, there is a debt of 20 lakh. Clear? Now EBIT in all the situation is earning before interest and taxes 2 lakh each. Clear? Now less interest in case 1, we have not taken any loan. No problem. In case 2, we have taken a loan of 10 lakh and ROI is 10%, so interest is 1 lakh. Case 3, we have taken loan of 20 lakh and ROI return of rate of interest is 10%. So our interest is 2 lakh. Clear? Now EBT in situation 1 there is 2 lakh and in situation 2 there is 1 lakh and situation 3 it's nil because our EBIT is 2 lakh and interest is also 2 lakh, no problem. Okay, earning before tax is nil. Now tax rate is at the rate 30%. So here 60,000 and here 30,000. Clear? And here is nil. Now profit after tax, see 1,40,000. Here 70,000. Here is nil. Now consider profit after tax in situation 1 is 1,40,000, second 70 and third it is nil. Number of shares is at the rate of this 10, 3 lakh, 2 lakh and 1 lakh only. Clear? Now here it's 0.47, 0.35 and here it is dash. Clear? Now in this case EPS of the company falling with the increased use of debt. It is because company ROI is less than the cost of debt. Clear? Now we have to find out the ROI. ROI in situation 1 is EBIT is 2 lakh into 100 upon 30 lakh. So it is 0.66. ROI is 6.67%. While the interest is 10%. So this is a situation of unfavorable financial leverage. Whereas the increased rate of debt on is 10%, this is a situation of unfavorable financial leverage. When ROI is less than cost of debt, financial leverage is unfavorable. In such cases, the use of the debt reduces the EPS. So trading on equity is clearly unadvisable in situation. So here, when your debt is higher than your profit, you shall use more and more of your internal fund or more and more use of equity. Even in case of X Limited, reckless use of trading on equity is not recommended because an increase in the debt may enhance the EPS but also increases the financial risk. Clear? So I hope this both the tables are clear to you. Now we are studying the factors affecting the choice of capital structure. So first is risk consideration. Now what does it mean the risk consideration? Risk consideration means use of more debt increases the financial risk of a business. Financial is referred to the position when a company is unable to pay its to meet its fixed financial charges. Whenever you are using more and more of the debt, what will happen? The interest burden on your will rise on your financial part. So you have to keep that thing under control. payment of interest and preference dividend and repayment obligation. Apart from financial risk, every business has some operating risk also called business risk. Business risk depend upon this operating cost, building rent, insurance, premium, salary, etc. Higher fixed operating costs result in higher business risk and vice versa. So the total risk depend upon business risk and financial risk. If a fund business risk is lower, its capacity to use debt is higher and vice versa. Clear? Second is cost of debt. So you have to always see the market situation. Whenever market is sluggish or showing downward trend when business is low. If you consider the situation of 2 months back, there was a huge slowdown in our economy. So whenever there is a slowdown, plenty of funds are available. At that time, taking of the loan is very good. But now it's in recovery mode. It's showing the B. Clear? Previously it has gone down. Now it is recovering. So it's in the recovery mode and it will go to the P. So nowadays debt will become costlier. So you have to always see the cost of debt and to assess the situation whether you are in favorable financial leverage or unfavorable financial leverage. Clear? Tax rate. Our third point is tax rate. So what is the situation of corporate tax in our country? Since interest on tax is a deductible expense, your cost of debt is affected by tax rate. A higher tax rate makes the debt relatively cheaper, hence more debt can be used. Clear? For example, borrowing is at 10%. Rate of borrowing is 10% and tax is 30%. Clear? So 10% minus 30% of the tax, your borrowing will come to 7% only. Clear? Because tax is applicable after deducting the interest. So 30% tax rate will be 30% of 10. So 10 minus 3, your debt will become at 7% only. Clear? Next point is ROI. Return on investment. If return on investment is higher, use more and more debt. If ROI is slower, then make more and more use of your internal capital or equity. Clear? Next is cash flow. What is cash flow position of your company? Clear? If you are having daily cash and even if your ROI is slow, or ROI is lesser, you can avail the loan because you are daily having the cash flow, so you can return the amount or pay the principal plus interest. Clear? But if you are an infrastructure company, you are preparing highway, flyover, cinema hall, complex building, they all are capital consuming business. Till 3 or 4 years, you have to continuously exhaust the capital. Clear? And nothing else. So always consider cash flow before taking the loan. Next is cost of equity. Clear? So cash flow plays a very major role in this thing. Clear? Cost of equity means expected rate of return on capital for assuming risk. When a company increases debt, financial risk faced by the equity shareholder also increases. Clear? So definitely when you are taking more and more debt, it will increase the financial risk and at the same time it may increase the EPS and may increase the return also. Increase or decrease, both things is possible. So you have to always consider the cost of equity, because if you do not provide adequate return to your shareholder, they will sell your share and run away. So this may also happen. Clear? Flotation cost. Now every loan comes with some cost. Clear? If you are raising a huge funds, 100 crore, 200 crore, so every loan comes with a cost and you have to bear that cost also. So the fundraising cost also, something cost of advertising, printing, prospectus, this is called flotation cost. Higher the flotation cost, less attractive the sources. For example, in share capital, what I told you, minimum subscription is 90%. So if you are not able to accrue minimum 90%, what will happen? you have to return the money. Now in case you have to return the money, your whole exercise has become worthless. Clear? Whole exercise. So it will incur you very high flotation cost. So always remember this thing in mind. Next is control consideration. Now what is control consideration? Debt normally does not cause a dilution of control. Issue of more equity, however, may reduce the management holding on the company and make it vulnerable to takeover. Therefore, companies afraid of takeover bid would prefer debt to equity. Okay? Sometimes what happens? Some fund management company will provide a restriction on the use of money. Though it is not happen in debt, but it generally happen at the time of equity. So you have to always consider whether debt is putting some control or over you or not. Hello? Next is flexibility. See, nowadays there is a situation of technological revolution or information technology. So if you have used your debt capacity to the full extent, clear? Now you will lose the flexibility to take further debt. To maintain flexibility, it maintains some borrowing power to take care of unforeseen circumstances. Because if you have already taken a full amount of the loan, means you are till neck, you are flooded with the loan. Now this news will get rotated in the market. So whenever any unforeseen situation comes, what will happen? You will not be able in a position to raise further loan. So always keep some flexibility so that you can ask for more and more loan. Next is ICR. It is called interest coverage ratio. Now this ratio is calculated to see whether you are able to pay your interest burden or not. So formula is EBIT upon interest, earning before interest and tax divided by interest. Whether you have the capacity to pay the interest on loan taken or not. Clear? Next to that is DSCR, debt service coverage ratio. Whether you are financially solvent or not and you are able to pay principal plus interest. For that purpose it is called DSCR, debt service coverage ratio. Clear? So what is the formula? EAT, earning after tax plus interest, clear, plus depreciation, clear, or any non-cash expense, clear, upon preference dividend plus interest plus debt or repayment obligation. So you will come to know about the debt service coverage ratio. So higher debt DSCR indicate better ability to meet cash commitment. It raises the company's potential to increase also debt component in capital structure. Next is stock market reaction. Clear? If you are financially sound, how your stock market react when the stock market is in rising bullish phase? More people invest in equity. Equity shares are more easily sold and even at higher prices. Clear? But when your market is sluggish, so in the bearish phase, you have to always see how stock market is behaving in the economy. Clear? Next is you have to also consider the capital structure of other companies. Capital structure of other companies, how other companies are behaving with you. Clear? And regulatory framework. Regulatory framework. Every company operates within a regulatory framework provided by the law. For example, public issue of the share and debenture are made according to the guidelines of Indian Companies Act 2013 and SEBI guideline. Similarly, raising funds from bank and other financial institutions require fulfillment of other norms. This has a bearing on capital structure also. Okay? So I hope this topic is clear to you. Capital structure concept and factors affecting. Clear? And I am also providing you one document containing objective type questions on this teaching. Please do solve. These are very important chapter related to your finance part and part B part. And these always come every year. The question related to this chapter will come. थैंक यू अखिला भाई।